I wish I could say like Dell from Melbourne, Florida asks, but I don't have that. So I'll make it up. Dell from Melbourne, Florida asks, what biological metrics would you recommend for measuring wetland restoration success? There's a softball there. Somebody take it.
We have a system that is called UMAN, which measures the progress or the improvement of a wetland. And we are starting that this year with the Fish and Wildlife Commission, but we do have a tool to measure the progress and I just want to say not only the progress, but also the science of the movement of the different habitat that we're trying to accomplish. And we look at the present, past, and future is a system, and I don't have it with me, but we do have something in place to do that for our easements. We do have something to measure. And also the Corps of Engineer, they use the same thing we use to measure their wetlands called UMAN.
So Jamie, the question was about biology?
Well, yeah, it says biological metrics.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting because the state of Florida, for years, they've developed a stream condition index, which includes the benthos and as well as physical habitat kinds of things. They've got a lake condition index that looks at the vegetation. And every time someone asks them about wetlands, they say, "Well, we're going to get to it eventually." There really aren't any that I know of. Certainly not in Florida, and not at EPA. Has there been any definitive list of kind of things that you would be measuring as far as the biota are concerned in wetlands? And part of that's because there's so many different kinds of wetlands. You know, you've got those that are riparian fringe, on rivers, on lakes. There's isolated wetlands and all those sorts of things. So it's not like there's going to be a one-size-fits-all. But because of that, I think that's why there's a lot of reticence to jump off on that, because it's a tough job.
Well, I might follow up. Do you think it's necessary to assign these biological metrics?
I think there, when I talk about seagrass in Tampa Bay, I think that, regardless of the type of wetland, I think if you had some kind of an indicator that was important for that in that setting, in that type of wetland, I think it would be. So it could be a fish. It could be some benthic organism. It might be some biological process. It's something that, whenever we do things, we talk about those kind of things and design monitoring programs, we talk about several things. One is there a good measurement system that's defensible for whatever the hell you want to measure? And, the other thing is it going to stand up, in terms of defensibility? Because if it's not going to be based on enough strong evidence, it's not going to last in terms of a management plan or any kind of a project. The short answer is yes. I think it's important to do that, but it may be something different in different systems.
We have a wetland science technology team in that's located in Texas that can come to each state, but it has to be specific on what you're looking for. It can't be broad. It has to be a specific item or situation you're looking for in order to measure it. So we do have a technology team on board that does that for us, that can come to each state and to help us measure our restoration. It is specific on what we're looking for in our restoration.
I was just thinking, looking back, the state of Ohio actually, I think, has a system for biological metrics for wetlands, and they've been working on that for quite a long time. Of course, they don't have saltwater marshes and those kind of things to deal with, so it's a little bit easier to deal with. But as I recall, they've got a system like that. So it's in the same vein as their stream index and their lake index. They have some for wetlands too, I'm pretty sure. And a lot of it has to do with fish.
Pete, you had something?
Yeah, the thing that's determining the rate of progress in Orange Lake right now is the public input process. And when you go to one of those meetings, it's kind of like this meeting, where you have people getting up and talking and telling them, you know, telling people what they're doing and what kind of projects they're doing and everything like that. But the piece of the puzzle that so often gets lost is the what's in it for me metric. I mean, we can measure biological function, but to the average person involved with the public input process and decision-making process, they got to know what's in it for them. What does this all mean? So in terms of this group, the biological metric, at the end of the day, when all of the projects we discussed, the wetlands reserve, everything, how many more ducks are we going to get? And if you come forward with that measurement or that prediction, how many more ducks, how many more ringnecks, how many more teal wood ducks, is all of this going to result in the state of Florida? That metric has more meaning to the average person, who is ultimately the one determining who gets money and where the money is spent, than the, you know, more, you know, scientific level measurements that you all have to use when you're doing your projects to determine whether or not they're working. But so how many more fish are we going to catch? How many more ducks are we going to have? And that metric will help temper some of the individual agendas associated with public input, because somebody feels strongly about we should do this and not that, and somebody wants to do this and not that. So if we can keep the eye on the ball, where are we all going when we get there? I think that is an important thing that should always be included in any you know, presentation about a project in front of the public.
That's a good thought. Hey, Don Coiner's over here going, yep, mm-hmm, yep. You got his vote. anybody want to follow up a question on that at all? This is a discussion, so you know, let's keep it going on the topic, and then we'll switch to a new topic if we need to.
Yeah, I just wanted to point out that the Everglades lawsuit used a very broad general metric, the narrative water quality rule of an imbalance of flora and fauna, which in that case was cattails overrunning native sawgrass. And of course, that's how we got to the 10 part per billion water, you know, phosphorus standard.
I'll say something, and I think Brian made a good point, and let me just expand on it. And I think it's one of the themes that, you know, in these type of meetings and advancements and, you know, dealing with water quality and habitat, is making this linkage between how some of these parameters, these water quality parameters, translate into maintaining or restoring integrity of ecosystems. And Brian brought up a good example where it took a lot of work, and it actually took a huge lawsuit where in court we had different perspectives that actually finally got to, in a court of law, exactly what that threshold phosphorus value was that caused the loss of integrity of the Everglades ecosystem. And that was where, what was that number? And they fought about it for years, of where the phosphorus concentration caused the cattails to take over the native sawgrass marshes. And again, those type of abiotic thresholds are very meaningful as they translate to maintaining ecosystem integrity. And we know that is something that the state of Florida is struggling with in terms of what are the nutrient criteria necessary to maintain biological integrity of spring systems, our riverine systems, our coastal estuaries, and indeed our coastal ocean. And Brian LaPointe and others have been involved with providing information to set those criteria that are very critical for our ability to maintain these ecosystems moving forward.
Try to look at these questions and fit natural segues. Sometimes it's difficult to do. I think this one might be a little bit of a segue from what we were just talking about and going into somebody, we'll say Doreen from Oviedo asks, what practices would make major impacts on improving the Indian River Lagoon water quality, and what are the obstacles to implementing those practices? There's a couple of Indian River guys over there, so.
This question brings out what some of the earlier presenters mentioned, that we actually need to let the data do the talking. And fortunately, as of March 2015, Brian LaPointe came through with a very nice paper that describes what is the main nitrogen contributor to the Indian River Lagoon. He used various isotopes on vegetation, mostly macroalgae, to make his decision. And he also used some very more interesting concepts on how nitrogen actually is mobilized from a leach field into the groundwater. And instead of going by the normal conceptual belief that it has to be nitrate, because nitrate moves very freely through a groundwater matrix, he has the position that, and I also share that position, that most likely in these coarse textured media that we have, the sandy media, that there's very little absorption of ammonium. And the nitrogen is moving from the leach fields into the lagoon as ammonium. And most people that have been monitoring these septic tank fields and the movement of nitrogen have been concentrating on nitrate, and therefore they have been missing the main contributor, which appears to be ammonia. And as the second part of the question is what can be done to ameliorate this situation? And obviously, when we have 300,000 septic tanks, we are looking at, in a relatively small area along the lagoon, 100-mile lagoon, we are looking at what we call a non-point contamination, where it's just spreading out and going down and into the lagoon. And therefore, we have to give ourselves some relief of that nitrogen input. And how do we go about that? Well, for one thing, we have to have connections with a sewage treatment plant. We can't have hundreds of thousands of septic tanks sitting out there. And secondly, if we do that, we have to look at what the Orange County people did and what other people are doing with advanced treatment technologies, what Tony has been talking about. So we have to lower the nitrogen load coming out and basically coming out of sewage that's going into the lagoon.
Let me just add on to what Roy just stated, and he did a very good job at iterating the really strong particular issues that are coming out now. But I want to make sure that everyone recognizes the contrast between the success story in Tampa Bay, where they aggressively identified nitrogen as a primary driver for habitat loss, seagrass loss, and fisheries loss in that system. And if you looked at some of his data, his milestones, they were addressing this like in the late 70s and 80s. And so by the end of the 80s, they had spent, what was it, $90 million on upgrading wastewater plants to tertiary treatment. That happened before 1990, when the Indian River Lagoon was named an NEP estuary of national significance. We failed to learn the lesson of Tampa Bay and the Indian River Lagoon. We have not learned that lesson yet. We are 30 years behind Tampa Bay. So the things that Roy just brought up, these are things that they dealt with, converting the secondarily treated wastewater plants along the lagoon to tertiary. I think we have one or two converted to tertiary along the lagoon. We know in wet weather events, they're still dumping sewage in. As Roy mentioned, 300,000 septic tanks. A lot of issues that we never stood up and identified from day one that were things that need to be identified to go forward and to get the water quality right so that we could turn around restoration of the seagrasses and the secondary production of that system of fisheries. So to follow up Roy's good statement, we have not aggressively done what was done in Tampa Bay, and we need to get there and start there real quick.
I'm from down around Fort Pierce, in Vero Beach, which is the southern part of Indian River Lagoon. And let me just say that Mosquito Lagoon, Banana River, that's a whole different situation than what we have. And also down towards Stewart with the Lake Okeechobee discharges, that's different. Where we are, the primary pollutant in the Indian River is fresh water, pure fresh water. And the reason for that is that originally, along the Indian River, there was a sand ridge where US 1 runs. And on the backside of the ridge, there was a swamp. And when it would rain in the summertime, the water would meander up against the ridge till it found an opening at the Sebastian River, down at the St. Lucie River, where it would finally drain into the lagoon. It would take months for a drop of rain that fell west of Fort Pierce to actually get into the river under the natural condition. And then, you know, in an effort to promote commerce and economic growth, the federal government authorized drainage districts to be established. And there's a daisy chain of drainage districts that start in Fort Pierce and go all the way up through Brevard County. And basically what they did was dig a canal around a big chunk of land and then a bunch of canals that connect them and dig through the sand ridge and discharge the water into the river. So now when it rains, the drop of water falls and it hits a canal and it blows to the river by the next day. And so the salinity levels in the river fluctuate between brackish to completely fresh, no salinity at all. And then, again, to promote commerce, we dug inlets. So now we let the ocean water interact where it didn't used to interact. So, and we put in control structures in the canals to hold back water for irrigation. So now when it's not raining, we stop the fresh water from going in the river and it's replaced by ocean water. So you have ocean water to pure fresh. And that fluctuation of salinity has a huge effect on the kinds of organisms that can survive under that that level of difference. And we're realizing that. People have now realized that. And while it's pretty hard to undo the drainage for your house and your garage, you know, you don't really want us to see anybody plug up your canal that would flood your house or my grove. What we are doing is recognizing that we need to have more water storage, and so the water management districts are actively buying land and putting in water storage and treatment, stormwater treatment areas, but they've also begun to contract directly with private landowners, because what they found out is that we can take a grower or a rancher, and they can actually put in a water control structure and stormwater treatment area and manage it for less than what it costs the state to buy the land and put in that same structure and do the same amount of work. So there's a new program underway in which the state and the water management districts are contracting with private landowners to store water. It's called water farming. And the first projects are really beginning to get underway now. Both St. John's and South Florida are looking at this. South Florida is probably a little more mature than St. John's, but I think you'll see that there as well. And I think over time, we realize that the land is overdrained and we have to do something about that. We obviously are limited in some cases because you can't start to, if it's overdrained in a city, you can't underdrain a city where people live, but we can do some things in the rural areas that can mitigate that problem. And I think you'll see the river begin to improve. And so while you have, you know, things like nitrogen overlaying all of this stuff, the fluctuation in salinity in the river and is also a huge factor, and we need to address both of them.
I'd like to ask a question to follow up on that. This is directed to Crennel. Based on what Pete just said, you know, about the water management districts contracting out with big landowners to hold on to water and stuff, how might that idea fit into some of the programs that your organization has, maybe to provide more incentive for them to do that? Or is this maybe in a direct conflict with what you want, because these might not be more natural type of areas, they may be more artificial areas? And so thoughts on that?
Let me chime in on that and say it's fundamentally different. In other words, if a landowner is contracting for water farming, we are contracting with a state agency to provide a service, okay? And that grower would still own the land and be bound by the contract for the term of the contract. And obviously, if it's flooded, you couldn't grow potatoes on it, but it is a very narrowly focused function. It's a contractual agreement that is only relating to one thing, water quality quantity. And the responsibilities of the landowner, the responsibilities of the agency. That's very, very different than a conservation easement where you're giving up all of your rights to use the land. And so the two kinds of contracts are fundamentally different pieces of negotiation. Both of them have a place, right, and everything like that. But you couldn't, for example, overlay a conservation easement on top of a water farming contract, I suppose. But then the problem is the landowner wouldn't be giving up his rights because he still has the right to farm water. So that's where you run into the conflict.
Water farming and water storage. We do have for the first time ever, we had one hour WRP easement did apply for South Florida to get some water storage, and they did get approved, and our national office approved it. But it comes with South Florida also funding the restoration with us, a 50-50. So we all coming halfway and meeting each other's needs and wants. So they got the water storage and we got the easement and we got the restoration we want. It all worked out for the good, because bottom line is that's what it's all about, bringing it back to historical use. But just so this situation here, you're storing more water. And so I believe it's that's the future for our programs. And we have another site up in Highlands County that we are working with Army Corps of Engineer and South Florida on another site
We want to use it as a filtration of the canal. So we are trying to work with other agencies in water storage and working with them for filtration out of the canals and go through our easement and go back into the canal. So did that answer your question?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No. Great. I just wanted to see how maybe they fit together. And, you know, just thinking about ways of collaboration and cooperation and, you know, different funding sources and stuff.
There's a question back there.
Yep.
So the freshwater making its way into the lagoon from these canals and you know, is still freshwater flows from the various creeks up and down. Obviously, those canals and creeks are carrying stormwater into the lagoon and are laden with nutrients.
Not necessarily. Stormwater is pretty clean coming out of the canals, out of groves and ranches. It doesn't have a lot in it.
It depends on what kind of stormwater you're talking about.
We have best management practices now where we manage the, you know, off-site runoff of nutrients and even the turbidity and everything like that. We're doing things on our farms and ranches to prevent that from happening.
I understand
what's coming out of there is pure rainwater.
Okay, I understand.
Not saying what's coming out of septic tanks.
I was referring not to stormwater coming off of a agricultural area where the water's been, you know, treated to some extent before it's released. I'm talking about stormwater coming out of urban areas. And I'll give you an example. One of the houses I own has a septic tank in the backyard. And the drain field pretty much takes up the whole backyard. And behind the backyard is a ditch. And that ditch is probably from the surface of my lawn in the backyard down to the bottom of the ditch is probably 10 or 12 feet. And it's always got water in it, so it's hitting groundwater, likely. Are we looking at the septic tanks leaching into the water that's in the canals, or along with the fertilizer products coming off the lawns? Any one of you?
I think, you know, Roy just gave a pretty good overview of the fact that septic tanks are incompatible at high densities with adjacent water quality and groundwaters and adjacent surface waters, if that answers your question. And, you know, clearly we're interested in all the sources and watersheds, and we're very interested in how the contribution of septic tank effluent stacks up versus some of these more nominal sources. But I think the point's been made by several speakers today that it's a very important source that hasn't been assessed adequately and addressed adequately by policy and management in the state.
Anybody else have any? Okay.
Hi, Chris Costello from the Sierra Club. I just want to challenge the water farming idea. I think it's unproven. There has been a lot in the newspapers and in a number of different environmental organizations reviewing those practices as less than effective. And so I just want to put that out there. I don't know if anyone wants to speak to that on the panel. But my question actually was put into the question box. And
Chris Costello from the Sierra Club asks,
and it actually goes to something regarding one of you said about the Indian River Lagoon being behind, I think it was Peter, hi Peter, about the Indian River Lagoon being behind Tampa Bay, and the question goes to Tony. The Nitrogen Management Consortium has been, those of us that know it well and really believe in it and are true fans, wonder if it is a model for other urban communities. And the question is, is it a model, and what are the limitations, what are the parameters within which you would have to work so that it would be a model? And I do understand that it's not for everyone because of the less industrialized, et cetera. So I'm wondering if you could talk about where it might be transferred in the state.
Well, maybe I can answer that first question about the water farming. I'll take the blame for that in some respects. We did a watershed plan for the South Florida Water Management District for C-44 and C-24 back in 1995, 96. And there were two things that we talked about. What they were asking us to do is figure out a way to store 100,000 acre feet of water a year because there was too much fresh water going into the St. Lucie estuary. We recommended two things. This was before, remember everything, all the answers were ASR a few years later, but they said we couldn't talk about ASR at that time. So we talked about two things. We talked about building a reservoir, and we talked about rehydrating dehydrated wetlands. And that's what the water farming really is. I mean, there are thousands of acres of drained pasture land that you could stack up a lot of water and allow that then to be taken at appropriate times, in drought times or whatever. At the same time, you're also recharging, depending upon exactly where it is, if there's some recharge areas, you're actually getting some of that water down into the water table. So I feel very strongly, I think that's a very effective means for water management, much cheaper and more effective than building a reservoir, which was our second answer to the question, and that's what they're doing now also. So there's a lot of good things that if you do it right, it's just like anything else. If you do it right, you can make things good. But if you don't do it right, no matter what it is, no matter how simple it is, if you screw it up, you're going to screw it up. So anyways, for what it's worth. That's the consortium. The consortium, there were several things I put up in that last slide that I thought were important in terms of why it was successful. But really, one of the really important things was effective leadership. And there were three guys in particular that I think, if they had a Mount Rushmore for Tampa Bay, they would be on Mount Rushmore. And one guy was a guy named Dave Moore. He was with Southwest Florida Water Management District. Another guy was Ralph Metcalf, who was with the City of Tampa, and he ran the single biggest point source into Tampa Bay. And Assistant County Administrator Jake Stowers from Pinellas County. And those are the guys that when we were sitting on the table, I'm just talking about, we were looking at, well, we got to address these future loads. And when we started, we had the adding machine going, and we said, oh, we don't have enough. They're the guys that stepped up and came up with the idea of a consortium. And they said, not one of us is going to be able to do this, but if we can convince everyone to contribute whatever they could, it makes it work. So, what you really need is some effective leadership at the right level in terms of the politics of things, if you will. These guys were with their agencies for a long time, and they had the courage to really step up and do what was the right thing to do. So it's nothing that can't be done anyplace else. Quite honestly, it's just a matter of having the right people at the right time, and we were lucky with that respect.
Yeah, I would more or less second that, Tony. It's leadership that's needed out there, and it's been shown in other areas. In Nebraska, for instance, we have a management system, and we happen to have one manager who was the manager of the Central Platte Natural Resource District. His name was Bishop, and he took the data that we had on isotopes and ran with it. And he ran with it by persuading the farmers, which was the basis of his board of 10 farmers, telling them that they're going to have to do something in order to reduce the amount of leachates that were going into the whole Platte Valley area. And he was successful at not only providing the impetus for the farmers to lower the amount of nitrogen they were applying, even though there were a number of farmers that said, we've always put 300 pounds per acre on, you know, and on and on and on with that kind of thing. And it's not us, it's septic tanks that are causing the problem when there's only probably, you know, 15 septic tanks in an area that's 20 miles long. And then he got the state to get on board with it, and he got the federal government to get on board with this thing. And from that came out these best management techniques. Now they're continuously being modified, being upgraded, but without his leadership, this would never have happened.
You know, I'd like to add one more thing. You know, one of the real important selling points, even though the work that I do is really cost effective, I mean, they did pay us to do all that work, but the great thing was, instead of one agency paying the bill, they could split it. And so, we're talking about, like single, digit, $2,000, $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000 a year for the city of Tampa. You know, I mean, it does the value that they got for that $5,000 or $6,000 was incredible, and that's because they worked together and they shared those costs. And that's a good selling point for trying to get something like a consortium off the ground. You know, the other thing is too is you got to I like to be the half half full glass. They want to see, is what they're doing making a difference? And so one of the other important parts, and I had it on that last slide, was having the data collection systems in place to show those people that are making those decisions that it's making a difference. And you know, one of the things that I've been working on with the local governments a great deal is developing a reporting system. So that it's, remember Ronald Reagan would only have like a one-page memo kind of thing, and that's the way things are. I mean, so we've been developing report cards, if you will, which are basically front and back of a piece of paper, and it gets across to especially the decision makers, are they making a difference in what they're doing? So communication is another important part of that consortium development.
Two things. First, in regard to best management practices and nutrients moving away from farms into water bodies, where down in the Indian River, we actually voluntarily, the growers got together, and we voluntarily decided to implement best management practices because we knew that there was a potential that our growers were causing an impact. It wasn't so much the nitrogen, it was more water quality and turbidity and things like that. But whatever the problems were, we said, well, we really don't want to cause problems. It would be better in the long run for everybody, us included, if we weren't having negative impacts. So what can we do to minimize those or even make them go away in some cases? So we began a voluntary best management practice process. We invited in FWC, we invited in the Department of Agriculture, the Department of Environmental Protection, and we spent about 2 years writing a manual, and we addressed every single thing you can imagine, every production practice we use in the grove. Everything's in this manual about what we can do to minimize or eliminate water quality issues and water quantity issues. So we were the first ones in the state to do that, and now, since then, the Department of Agriculture took that program and expanded it, and I would say statewide and in citrus, the compliance, and it's all voluntary compliance, nobody's required to sign up, but the compliance rate is over 90%, and it's since expanded to beef cattle and other crops, vegetable crops, ornamentals, and so the majority of your agricultural producers now in Florida are voluntarily participating in best management practices. And And the deal is this, you have to remember things from the farmer's standpoint, and I can't speak to how the fellows in Nebraska feel, but I know this, and that is that if somebody tells me that nitrogen from my grove is getting in the Indian River, the thing I think about is, you know what? I bought that nitrogen. I paid some guy to bring it to the grove, and I paid to apply it, and my intention is for that nitrogen to make an orange. The last thing in the world I want to see is the nitrogen in the Indian River. I want it to be an orange. So when you sit a bunch of guys down and say, you know, this is what's happening to your nitrogen, the first thing they say, hey, where do I sign up? I want my nitrogen to become oranges. I don't want it to become pollution in the Indian River. So that's why we have such a high level of compliance. What you're going to find is most farmers are pretty reasonable people, and they get it. And in terms of water farming, I'll end with this, and that is that we in agriculture have been storing water and creating water supplies for ourselves for many, many years, since long before the 1990s. And in reality, the original drainage districts were dug in the 30s, and somewhere around the 60s and 70s, people realized this probably wasn't such a good idea. It was causing a negative environmental impact. And so they began to retrofit those to be storage. They changed the name from drainage districts to water control districts. But basically, any new development, agricultural development, has gone in the past 30 years, has had its own on-site storage, stormwater attenuation, so we don't cause these off-site impacts. So we've been doing this at our own expense, as required by the water management districts, for many years. It's not like we don't know how to do it. And the only difference is, instead of just storing the water that we need for our groves, we're now going to store the water for the Indian River on larger areas. So there's no question about whether or not water farming is a good idea. There's no question about whether or not it works. There is some distrust, I suppose, from people thinking that we're going to trust private individuals to act in the public interest. And in reality, that's probably what's taken most of the focus the past 3 years, is coming up with an agreement that wasn't based on trust. It was based on a contract between the state and the local grower, to where the grower was required to meet certain requirements and be subject to certain inspections. So it's not an Iran kind of agreement. This is a deal where everything's spelled out in detail and there's measurements and all this sort of thing. So, and the growers are confident that we can comply because we already know we can do it.
I've heard Newton Cook say many times that the duck hunting in the created stormwater treatment areas south of Lake Okeechobee is world class. Is there anything we could do to enhance that duck hunting in these created wetlands, or are there things that we could do to tweak the restoration of the wetlands that we're working to make them more productive for duck production and recreational use?
Let me just say, a lot of these individual grower-owned water farming facilities will be private, and there's all kinds of issues with liability. And remember, we're focused most directly on water farming. The best thing I can say is that it will grow more ducks. Whether or not you can specifically hunt on that reservoir doesn't mean you're not going to get good out of it, because it's going to grow more ducks in the state. And ultimately, you'll benefit by having these water farming things as a duck hunter as well, even if you can't get on through the lock gate to get to that.
Water farming locations, but the very expensive stormwater treatment areas that we're creating, which SDA 5 being a classic example of at least purportedly being world-class duck hunting. Can we enhance those areas to be even more productive and provide greater recreational value?
I'm looking around. I don't see anybody from the South Florida Water Management District here. Yeah, that's be great if we had one of them hanging around and try to answer that question.
Well, I'm not a duck biologist, okay, but I'm sure that there's a lot of research out there for different types of ducks and what their habitat needs and optimal habitats are. So I got to imagine there's things that you could do to besides providing the right hydrology is the right physical structure for their habitat.
I just wanted to let people know that at UCF, in a partnership with MacArthur Agroecology Research Center out of Buck Island Ranch near Archbold Biological Station, about a year ago, we finished up a project looking at the Florida Ranchland Ecosystem Services Project, which is designed to hold back water and nutrients. But no one at the time was thinking to look at habitat quality. And so we got an EPA STAR grant to investigate that, and we'll get our results published in about a year. But I can give you the brief outcome of that. And what we found is that there's a real sweet spot where if you can hold the water up somewhere in the 25 to 40 centimeter range, so that's 10 inches to 16 inches, so basically one board in a water control structure, you can enhance the habitat for invertebrates, for fish, and for native plants pretty effectively. If you hold more water on, that tips it the other way. The habitat goes, it's not as much of a gain as you could get. If you can't hold that much water on, it gets really flashy, and then you get great mosquito production, which obviously the ranchers don't want, the public doesn't want, nobody wants. I really wanted to look at the waterfowl and the birds, but I got outvoted by our team. So we don't have data on the ducks, unfortunately. But what we did observe is that we got a lot more waterfowl in the places where the water was being held back in these degraded wetlands on pastures. And in this particular project, the pastures were still grazed. I mean, there's no restriction on the cattle. They came and went. But it was the holding back of the water that really increased the habitat, because now your wetlands had water for a change.
So you said your team decided not to look at waterfowl and birds. Yeah, sounds like you need a new team. All right. Anybody else want to? Oh, okay.
I got a simple question, but I got a comment first regarding the water storage. I moved to Florida in 84, so I've been here a while. But prior to that, I grew up in Iowa. And Colonel and I have talked about easements in Iowa. And another thing they have are areas that are no trespass areas on public land where they, you know, they enhance habitat for waterfowl, and in some cases in the surrounding intermittently wet areas, they enhance it for deer, and they grow crops for them. And you know, you personally, those areas are what keep the ducks in Iowa during the migration for a longer period of time, whether you can hunt them or not. And I think that water farming is going to have the same effect. Right. I personally disagree with people that think it's going to suck all the ducks off public land. That's my opinion, okay? My question is, I'm not familiar with how deep they plan to manage the water depth in these on these water farms, and if you can answer that.
It depends on the farm. In other words, if they're going to do it in conjunction with a conservation easement, then, you know, wetland restoration would also be part of the objective. So you wouldn't want to hold it at a level that, as you say, degraded the wetland the other way. So if that's your kind of joint objective, you can accomplish those things. But then there's going to be other ones where a grower has land that used to be a grove. It got wiped out from canker or greening, and they're perhaps risk averse or have more acreage than they can get planted in the next 10 years simply because of finances and risk. And in that case, they would contract to say, all right, I'll put a dike up, I'll put water control structures in according to your design, and I'll operate them according to your regulation schedule. And remember, part of it with the water farming is not only to keep the fresh water from going into the river during the rainy season, it's to release fresh water to the river during the dry season to dilute the salt water that's coming out of the inlet. So it's a two-way street. It is a service that to store the water and then release it according to the regulation schedule that the agency would determine. And In that case, it's a contractual obligation to do that, and it's about the Indian River. It is not about the habitat on the piece of land where you're doing the water farming. So in that case, you may not be looking at the biological function of the water farm itself, except as it relates to the biological function of the river that it's designed to restore.
Some of the negative comments I've heard about water farming is that some folks just think it's a way to store water so that it can end up being potable, used potably down in Miami or someplace. And that's, unfortunately, the use of water farming as a terminology, is really not a good euphemism. Because I think the intent all along was to improve Indian River Lagoon and not provide a new water source, for potable use.
Agreed.
That's where the rub, I think, has come from many of the environmental groups, and maybe Chris.
All right.
It goes back to the, and Pete, you were talking about the trust factor. I think that's, if you go into a situation and you inherently just have a distrust for what the other side is looking at, you're never going to come to a compromise and the right decision. At some point, there has to be some reasonable degree of trust. You can leave it up to the lawyers and write contracts, but at the end of the day, you've got to look at it as the two of you working on it to solve the same problem.
All right, we're pushing 4:40 right now, so, and I appreciate everybody staying a little bit. I do have one more question. I want to ask it just simply because I begged and to have people put questions in. I would hate to not ask the question. And Mark's over here smiling. He thinks I'm setting up a joke, but I'm not. water management districts, they continue to regulate water levels. And we'll just say that Taylor from Tallahassee asks, what impacts does this regulating water levels, not maintaining them at static levels, what impacts does this have on sediment deposition and overall quality of marshes? So would somebody like to try to field that question?
I think just a general comment, and this is probably a summary statement from what we heard today. If we go back to those presentations this morning on the Carolina Willow, was that hydrology was implicated in the reason why we're seeing more expansion of this species in historic, more herbaceous wetland areas. So maybe to get at the answer to the question is that hydroperiod is very critical, and that is in the dynamic of it, that we're not going to keep static hydrology in the state of Florida, where we have monsoonal rains from, a large difference between dry season, wet season, the El Ninos. So I do think the flip side answer to the question is that, indeed, if we want to restore habitat, then we need to pay attention to these issues of hydrology as they relate to maintaining the type of habitat that we want to have in a, quote, restored ecosystem.
One of the jobs that streams as wetlands have is to deliver sediment to the receiving water body. So if you have flows that preclude the ability of the stream to move that sediment downstream, it's not going to be good.
I can say that based on our restoration we have done so far, because we don't allow pumping of water in our easement, water level plays a big factor, because most of our easements are next to canals and next to a major water body. And when these levels go down, our easement is like a sponge, just everything just goes. And then we start getting this, the willows and the wax myrtles and the different species that we don't want. So it's a tough situation for us when you talk about historical. I mean, we really can't reach the historical when you talk about measuring a wetland. when you got a major canal next to your easement, your historical is going. I mean, we can't even accomplish what we want to accomplish because of the level of the water. So that plays a major factor in everything that we do based on, and I can think of one of them that we know that's affected, that is in Highlands County called Buck Island Ranch. That ranch, if that water drop, level drop of just an inch, the whole ranch is dried up. And we have several easements on that ranch, and we try to meet our habitat community, and it's all gone because we can't keep the water there stagnant long enough to reach that marsh we're trying to reach. So I think it's a problem just throughout the whole state of Florida and trying to reach that community you're trying to reach. And we talk about fighting willows. We're going to be fighting willows. As long as you got canals in Florida, you're going to fight willows. So.
All right. I'll try to make it quick and just say my granddad bought his first grove in Davie in the June of 1947, and along about September it started raining. And by the end of that hurricane season, everything was flooded from the Kissimmee Valley all the way down to Homestead. And we had an old barn, had aluminum siding on the grove, and there was a line on that barn about as high as this table. And on the side, there were these little lines that looked like tree rings. And every time the water would drop an eighth of an inch, it would sit there and etch the aluminum because it was acid. And you could see hundreds of these lines. So that land was flooded for months, literally. And so when people talk about regulating the water, the first thing I say is look at your feet. If they are dry, then the number one reason for regulating water has been successful. Now let's talk about all the other stuff we need to accomplish. And the point of the matter is that unless everybody leaves and takes their stuff with them, it isn't going to be restored. And therefore, it's not a question of doing that. It's a question of how do we make it better? And can we get better every day? And the answer is the more we learn, the more we all agree and build consensus, the more likely it is we're going to get better. And I think that's what everybody wants. I know that's what everybody wants in the agricultural community, I'm sure the environmental community, and the public as well. So that's the place to focus, not on what are we doing wrong, but what are we doing to get better. That's really the place to look.
And with that, I think that's a great message to end where the Waterfowl Summit. Gentlemen, I appreciate you sitting on the panel, taking the time to discuss everything. There was a lot of good thoughts that came out of this, and you know, I've got some things swirling in my head that make me go home. I know that John's doing the same thing. There's a few other folks in the audience that are thinking other things. So I appreciate everybody who stuck it out to the end. We're a little bit over, and I know that's always a concern with John, is are we going to have enough to fill up the time? So apparently we did. I think we're doing well. I appreciate everybody on behalf of John Hitchcock and the Florida Wetlands Forever and United Waterfowlers of Florida, and myself and the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. Thank you, everybody, panel members, invited speakers, everybody. I thought it was a success, and I'm really happy with it. So thank you very much.